Hi, I'm here at Rockland Distilleries Toddy Estate. This is one of them. And you can see there's a lot of coconut trees here, and it's about 18 acres. And it's located at Chilaw district. And this place is called Katuapitia. And Indika here is going to show me how the toddy tapping is done. And he's been doing it for 22 years. I know it's really hard, but he's going to take us through how the process of toddy tapping is done, which is a hard, really, and it's really hard thing to do. And he's going to take us step by step how this toddy tapping art is done. Okay, the first step, in order for them to climb the trees, they had to sharpen their tools because they will be covering 25 to 30 trees at the time. So he's going to sharpen the tools because every tree they can't climb up and then come down. So they need to have the tools sharpened before they head to the trees. So Indika had already sharpened the knife. It's really sharp, and you can see like it's really ready now for him to climb the tree to cut the coconut flour. And it looks really good, but it's really sharp. So I'll just leave it to him to start the process. So that's the knife it's going to be used for them to cut the flour. When they go up, they will just use that to cut the flour. And then this is another tool, which is to tap the coconut flour. And so I'll give it to him that. And then this is the knife that they use to cut the flour. And these are very sharp. And he's ready now. And they need to have one of the pots so that they can collect all the liquid into it. And this is the precious liquid that comes out of each tree. They shouldn't be wasting, every single bit is very important. So they had to collect it. And they have to safely bring this down before they make the coconut arrack. So Indika is about to climb the tree. So before they do, there's a ritual. They do follow a prayer before they climb the trees. So they're just praying at the moment, and he's going to climb the tree to get the toddy. So Indika had climbed the trees and then collected the toddy. So you can see, like, I can smell the coconut flavor coming out of it. So it's from two trees. And so what he had to do is, like, he climbed the trees and then tapped the flour, and then he had to shave it, and then he had to fill it in another container and then pour it in. And also there's pots hanging down as well, because they're covering 25 to 30 trees. So the pots that's on the ground, what they do is they will take it up and then pour the collected liquid into those pots and then send it down for the people who are working down, and they can just collect all the toddy so that the pots will be empty and it's easier for them to collect the toddy from 25 to 30 trees. And so now we're going to taste this, and it looks really nice. And normally what it does is, like, as soon as they started collecting the toddy, it does start fermenting very quickly. So they have to start the process very quickly as well. So we'll taste the toddy first, the fresh toddy, how it tastes like. And this is one of the ways that they've used years and years ago in Sri Lanka to make hoppers. They use the toddy, fresh toddy, to ferment the flower as well. So we're going to taste that and then I will let you know how it tastes like. Okay, Indica is going to show me the process, how when he climbs to the trees, how he collects the nectar from these coconut flowers. And the coconut flowers weighs about 10 kilos and this normally produces about 40 coconuts. And he's going to show me the demo, how he's going to tap the flower and also how he's going to shave the flower to collect that nectar. Okay, Indica Patanganda. So they got to tap about 100 times in order for all the nectars to collect when they're collecting. So it opens up all the glands and the coconut to come out, the coconut water to come out. So he's going to show me how it's done. It is actually an art, and I don't think everyone can do this, and you need to be really trained, and also they need to weigh about at least 50 to 70 kilos because otherwise they can't climb these trees. And it's the technique that they use in order to shave the coconut flower is like totally different. So he's shaving the coconut flower, and in order to get the coconut nectar, they have to really follow this process. And it's like you can see like how he's shaving it. I don't think we can do it. It's not really easy thing to do. You need to be really trained to do this. So I'm just watching him how he's doing this. Okay, Indica is about to show me how we're going to strain this coconut nectar. And this is a natural husk made out of coconut. And he's going to pour the liquid. Because they had to strain it, there's a lot of bees and flies because it's a rich nectar. So they had to strain it before consuming it. And I can smell it's already started fermenting because it does have natural fermenting agent in the coconut nectar. So it's like already fermenting. So this is the way in Sri Lanka traditionally when they collect the toddy and they drink the toddy, these sort of things that they eat along with it. So it's sort of like a snack, if you call it now. And this is called mayok, which is a, we call it cassava, I think, and which is served with coconut sambal and a chili sambal, which is a chili that's really spicy. And they serve that with the toddy to give that flavor. And when you're eating it, you can get the freshness of the toddy as well as the cassava and the all the sambals as well. So he's going to give me some toddy to taste. This is the first time I'm going to taste toddy. So Indica going to pour some toddy for me. Thank you, and I'm gonna taste it. It smells like really rich coconut flavor. You can smell it before even you drink the toddy. It's so yum because it doesn't get any fresher than this, and it does have lots of coconut flavor, and it's naturally sweet, and you can even taste the yeast as well. And at the moment it's about 3% alcohol in it, and they have to take it to the distillery to make the process for the coconut arrack. And if it's like after 24 hours, it turns into a coconut vinegar, and which you can use it for the cooking as well when you're making acharu and things like that. And it's really nice. As it's like when it's really hot, you can drink quite a bit of this. And it's similar taste like a cider, apple cider. And you can call it coconut cider. It's really nice. Russia is known for their vodka, Japan is known for their sake, and Sri Lanka is known for arrack. And today I'm here at Rocklands with Amal De Silva Vijayaratne, the CEO and Managing Director. Thank you, Amal. Thank you for the opportunity. And thank you again.
Thank you, Diane.
And Amal, I know that Rockland is making arrack since 1924. And what's the uniqueness about the Ceylon Arrack?
Okay, so we are family, fourth-generation family distillers from 1924, the first commercial distillery of Sri Lanka. Now, my grandfather and uncle believed that cognac was a smoother drink than whiskey. Well, of course, it's your preference. And so the first stills were bought in France from Ibabe and Sons, who were the premier still makers at the time. Now, they were very good friends with Mr. Pasteur, you know, as in pasteurization. So he knew how to make a still, and with his knowledge, they combined this knowledge and knew how to distill a thing that ferments naturally in a really wonderful way. And so some of those secrets that we learned from Louis Pasteur, along with the most famous still makers of the time, are still being handed down generation to generations. And I think that gives us a very, a very particular, beautiful signature. Ceylon Arrack, of course, is different in the sense we also one of the only or the only distillery at the time to have our own toddy tapping estates. So some of the toddy for this product also comes from our own estates. Now we've been making arrack from 1924, but to make a truly artisan unique blend, a masterpiece, is what we wanted to create when we wanted to take arrack to the world. This was the original vision of our founders, to take arrack to the world, but it taken us this long to get here, I guess. So making the blend of Ceylon Arrack alone took us 4 years just to get the blend right, even though we've been experts or, well, trying to do the best we could for so long. So I think those a combination of facts that make Ceylon Arrack unique. Another thing is the role of master distiller and master blender has only stayed in the family distillery since 1924. So even today at 9:30 in the morning, you'll find my father, chairman, doing the tastings of after it's distilled, and then when before product is blended, they'll taste it again.
I would like to know, like, you know, obviously you would have overcome a lot of issues in the past, like, you know, tsunamis and things like that. How are the issues, like, you know, shape the business?
Well, yeah, we've been through the Great Depression in 1924, soon after the business was established, then the Second World War, burned to the ground in a fire in 89, the tsunami destroyed half the business. And I think with each one, rather than looking at the glass, an empty glass, we looked at it as half full. So every time we built it better than before. And the distillery, when it was constructed, last after 89 and was reopened in 92. You know, it didn't have frills and it wasn't designed to look pretty or whatever, but as you would have seen, it's built to be absolutely eco-friendly as possible. And that's what mattered to us. We weren't worried about what it looks. So it's been a really long journey. And but we sometimes wonder, we must be mad to continue to do this all these years. But you know, it's something in our we are deeply passionate about.
Where do you see the Rocklands in the next 2 to 4 years, where it's heading to, or the industry, the arrack industry?
Well, interestingly, we've actually been working on Ceylon Arrack. It was launched in London in 2009. So it's over 10 years we've been working on taking arrack to the world. And by talking about arrack, I think we made Sri Lanka famous as well, in a sense, because with each bottle, each story, each article, each PR press, it's something good for Sri Lanka. And this year in London, well, last year, earlier this year, we were featured by BBC. And this year in London alone, if you look at, there are three or four new Sri Lankan restaurants opening, and same in Australia. So we are very, very excited about this. And for me, arrack, Ceylon Arrack is, now you mentioned earlier, we got tequila and whiskey and things like that. For me, Ceylon Arrack is what Patron or tequila was before Patron. And this is just the earliest days, and we're only just beginning now, Diane.
The other question I wanted to ask is, How do you find different flavors? Like, you know, I've seen like different flavors. So do you normally like infuse different flavors into the arrack, or how do you go about using different flavors into the arrack?
That's a beautiful question. And I can see you why the chef in you is coming out now with that question. So we don't add any flavors to the arrack. It's 100% pure natural toddy distilled and aged. Now, when you age arrack, if you age it in younger wood, and we use halmila wood, which is endemic to Sri Lanka and South India, which is equivalent of oak, a very dense wood. Young wood has a lot of tannin in it. A slightly older barrel has less tannin in it. And a large vat versus barrels does different things to the arrack. Now, on top of that, the arrack sitting by the window where at 12 o'clock a stream of light falls in, the one on the corridor where there's a constant draft, they all acquire different personalities and flavors. The role of the master blender is very much like a chef. He's got to take and know the nuances of all these and put that blend, that recipe together. And his job is to do that time and time again. And so, in a way, it's very much like being a master chef, the master blender's role. And sometimes we get it wrong as well.
Thank you so much, and thank you for having us here, and thank you so much for your time, and greatly appreciate your opening up and talking about the Ceylon Arrack, how you made that brand very popular among overseas, like, you know, especially at the moment they're selling that in Australia and UK, and they're making like different cocktails and everything. It's just opening up how people can use the arrack and use it for different purposes, and also like I made ice cream with it as well. So there's like so many opportunities that you could make different stuff with arrack. So it's not only for drinking purposes, but you can use it for cooking purposes as well. And I really appreciate your time, and thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Diane. Thank you.